Welcome to the Austrian Military Academy in Wiener Neustadt. I'm Colonel Markus Reisner, the head of the Institute 1 for Officers Basic Training. And today in our new video, we would like to have a look at a special capability which is of importance for both sides in the war for Ukraine. And this is electronic warfare. Before we start, let's have a look about the different domains of warfighting. So we have the classic domain of the land, maritime, air and space domain, and we have of course the information cyber domain. Currently, the electromagnetic spectrum is becoming more and more the decisive domain. Therefore, we will have a look at this domain today. Therefore, I would like to introduce an expert to you, Major Schmid, who is an expert on that topic.
Thank you for the introduction, sir. Welcome from my behalf. I'm a specialist in the fields of cyber, electronic warfare and information operations. And now I will talk you through these sectors. First of all, let's make some limitations. What you're seeing here is not electronic warfare. This is computer network operations, or sometimes information operations. When we talk about electronic warfare, it's more like this. It's about radar signatures, signals, transmitting and fighting on the electromagnetic spectrum in a certain electromagnetic environment. Well, let me now talk you through some basics. This is what we call a wave. A wave has a certain length. This is what we call the wavelength. From the climax up to the bottom, it's called amplitude. And one rhythm is an oscillation. So one oscillation in 1 second equals 1 hertz. Well, now that we have talked about the basics, let's have a closer look on the electromagnetic spectrum in general. On the left side, you would see something like electromagnetic radiation, electromagnetic fields, something we would call in general non-ionizing radiation. In the middle area, you would be looking at something which we would call the visible spectrum, like visible light, infrared or UV. And on the right side of the spectrum, you'd have something like sun rays, gamma rays, X-rays, up to what we would call in general ionizing radiation or radioactive radiation. Well, let's take a closer look at the details. On the upper hand, you would have a modulator, which equals the message of the signal. You would have a carrier frequency where the signal is transmitted on. So you could either use it via amplitude modulation, where you modulate the amplitude, or you could use it via frequency modulation, where you modulate the wavelength. Those are the two basic forms of signal transmissions. And as you can imagine, interferences or disturbances have an influence on the carrier signal and therefore on the message, which we would call the modulator. Now, what does that mean for signal intelligence? So if you would like to recce some kind of signals, you need to bear in mind a few things you need. On the one hand, you would need an array of detectors. On the other hand, a target. By knowing the exact frequency of the target, you could triangulate a certain position where the target might be, because it's not that clear where it is exactly. You would call that, or one would call that, an error triangle, because in this triangle, it's certain that the target will be. So let's combine it with doctrine. Each of the dots we will be now seeing represents a certain frequency. And by calling into the electromagnetic spectrum, one might find something which looks like this. So each dot represents either a transmitter or a receiver. We can see the different colors and how they work together. We now identified as well the one transmitter who will always make the first call. As well, we could recognize a transmitter on the far left side and a transmitter on the far right side. So what does this mean? These are transmitters which share some frequencies but not all. Now, doctrine-wise, we could say that all these are units, and the one who was making the first call would be the main command post. When thinking about main command posts, they are not that close to the forward edge of battle area. So we could try to separate the battlefield like this. With this separation, some things get clearer, because in front of the forward edge of battle area, you would have some reconnaissance units. And on the back of the edge of battle area, you would have some artillery units. They would fire out of a position area artillery. When looking at these units, you could see that they only share one frequency. This might lead us to the assumption that this is a UMCP, a unit maintenance collection point, or even a medical treatment facility. By knowing that this is a medical treatment facility, we can decide that this might be a headquarters element. A headquarters element operates in a supply area. This leaves one unit in the north, which could be a reserve. By now knowing that these are the rear elements, we can assume that this is the main effort. Now it's the enemy's turn. They would like to know where is the recce, where is the reserve, and where is the artillery, in order to destroy the command post, in order to suppress the artillery. They want to destroy the reserve as well. They want to fix the units in the front. They want to penetrate the lower unit, and then they want to suppress the depth and neutralize the unit maintenance collection point. Now we understand the basics of signal intelligence. Let's take a look at deception, disruption, and interference. How does this work? So basically, you would have two major parts. On the one hand, you would have importing false targets, and on the other hand, electronic masquerade. Let me talk you through importing false targets now. The ground bounce is a type of interference where you would bounce the signal from the ground to the missile in order to confuse the missile where the signal is coming from. The missile would now think that the signal is coming from below, so therefore would crash into the ground. Cross-eye is a special kind of radar transmission which is done to, let's say, play a target where no target is. Therefore, the missile is confused and cannot find the real target anymore. Blinking is also a special kind of deception, where you would alternate signals from left, right, top, down, in order to overheat the servo motor and crash the missile. When talking about electronic masquerade, one would talk about the broadband jamming, which you could see as a barrage jamming. It's a very broad and loud spectrum, as well as some spot jamming, where one frequency is jammed directly. The second would be the hybrid jamming, which is quite good, mixture of both, but it's very energy consuming. And the last one is what we would call active erasure, active cancellation, where you would send a signal which is 180 degrees out of phase in order to cancel that wave. Well, let's take a look on how this operates together. In this video, we will focus on Russian systems only. So, while the LEAR 3 platform takes over the reconnaissance and the control with the Orlan 10 UAV, text messages and fake calls are sent to all Ukrainian cell phone users with a Ukrainian number. So the soldiers get confused and decepted. At the same time, firing an artillery battery is detected, which causes the Mercury B system to confuse the ground proximity sensor of the artillery shell to trigger the grenade. Zittels are provided networks across the whole battle line to provide reconnaissance for their own troops. They would find drone swarms, which Sepiars and Borisoglevsks would detect and jam them in order to suppress. Moskvas on the battlefield in the operational depth would detect aircrafts and swarm of drones up to 400 kilometers. And the Krasuka 4 system prevents aircraft from communicating, again, disable radar systems, and precise spot jamming is carried out. The Krasuka 2 prevents now the aircraft from communicating and can disable AVACs as well as radar-guided missiles, which we could see in the examples before. Finally, the Murmansk systems clear up to 5,000 kilometers of short and medium wave radio equipment, recce them, and can jam it if necessary. Now we have a basic knowledge about signal intelligence, deception, and disruption. EW is a hidden weapon. You can use electronic attack measures, electronic support measures, and as well as electronic protection measures. On the right side of this slide, you can see on the southern part at the Black Sea, red hexagons. These red hexagons represent the jamming of GNSS systems. GNSS stands for Global Navigation Satellite Systems. On this image, you can see Tallinn, which is located in the Balticum, and also different kind of other sectors which suffer from electronic attack measures. We talked about JDAMs as well as storm shadows, HIMARS, Excalibur, and drones, which can be jammed in order to degrade their performance. On a video by Colonel Reisner, we could now also see that currently Russian troops use fiberglass optics in order to have a workaround over the electromagnetic spectrum, and now drones have a function of an anti-tank guided missile. Let's take a closer look at the systems we were discussing before. Here we would have the Murmansk system, which is recognizable due to this tall mast system, and its purpose is to make recce and disruption available. It operates against low frequency and mid frequency waves in an operational depth or a range up to 5,000 kilometers, which equals around 3,100 miles. The spectrum is from 3 Hz up to 30 MHz. Next is the Krasuka 2 system. Its purpose is deception and disruption. It mainly operates against radar-guided missiles and AVEX systems. The range, or the operational depth, is up to 250 kilometers, which equals around 155 miles. And the spectrum is from 2.86 up to 3.54 gigahertz. The Krasuka 4, which main purpose is disruption, recce, and signal intelligence, usually operates against satellite communication as well as radar systems. The range is up to 300 kilometers, which equals around 190 miles. The spectrum, 8 to 18 gigahertz. The Moskva 1 system has its main purpose in reconnaissance and signal intelligence as well. It operates against airspace systems and drones. The range, or the operational depth, is again up to 400 kilometers, which equals around 250 miles. The spectrum ranges from 200 megahertz up to 18 gigahertz. Now let's talk about some tactical electronic warfare systems. This system, the Layer 3 with the Orlan 10 drone, are usually found together. Their main purpose is to reconnaissance, decept, and make information operations, which I will focus in this video. It operates mainly against cell phone users in a range up to 140 kilometers, which equals around 90 miles, and its spectrum is from 900 megahertz up to 1.9 gigahertz, which is comparable to GSM. The Mercury B systems we have seen before usually operate against artillery shells and radio systems, because their purpose is to make electronic countermeasures and decept. The range is up to 400 meters, which is not much, and can be compared to 0.2 miles. The spectrum in which it operates is 90 megahertz up to 420 megahertz. The Borisoglebsk II system has the purpose of reconnaissance and deception again, and it operates mainly against radio systems and UAVs. The range is up to 130 kilometers by detection, which equals around 80 miles. And the spectrum ranges from 1.5 megahertz up to 960 megahertz. We have talked about the Zittel system as well, which purposes to decept and recce as the other systems. The Zittel system usually operates against satellites like GNSS systems, GSM or satellite communication, as well as UAVs. Range is up to 50 kilometers, which equals around 30 miles, and it operates in the spectrum 100 megahertz up to 2 gigahertz. The last system I have shown you was the SAFIRE system, which is a civilian and military system which can be a dual use good. It operates as signal intelligence platform and is able to make electronic countermeasures. It operates against UAVs and as well again as against GNSS. And the range is up to 3 kilometers, which equals around 2 miles. The electromagnetic spectrum in which it operates can be ranged in between 300 megahertz up to 6 gigahertz. On the lower half of the screen, you can see the destroyance of the last system in the Kursk area, which was taken out by Ukrainian special forces. On this last slide of the presentation, I would like to emphasize that electronic warfare is a hidden weapon. It happens all the time, everywhere, and across all borders. This brings us into the situation that we're facing a battlefield of complexity, and there is therefore a need to understand electronic warfare and manage all the systems in order to stay ahead.